It is my pleasure to welcome Senator Romney.
Thank you.
I want to just start and get your perspective on leadership. You're new to the Senate, so you're not an executive in this seat. You're now a legislator, I guess, in some respects, and that's got to feel different. But just talk about what leadership means to you and how you've thought about leadership over the course of your career in the various jobs that you've had.
Well, both in private equity and before that in consulting, I got the chance to work with a lot of executives and to get a sense of who were people that were highly successful and effective leaders and who were less so. And it struck me that in terms of major decision makers, there were some that had a great gut. They'd say, hey, this is an opportunity, we ought to go here. And somehow their gut was not always 100% successful. It worked for a while, and then there'd be some kind of a disruption that was not something they anticipated. There were other people that were driven more by cold, hard data and solid analysis. I tended to want to invest in the latter group. And to find people that believed in gathering information, more information than anybody else had, in ways, perhaps gathering it in ways that hadn't been thought of before, but gather the information, analyze it all sorts of ways, look for relationships, and then make decisions on that basis. So I was drawn to that kind of person and found them to be the most effective leaders to invest in. Number two may not come as quickly to people's minds, but I had the chance of working with a number of executives. One was Bill Marriott of Marriott International, and obviously a highly successful entrepreneur and manager and leader. And what distinguishes him in my mind is a little unusual, and that is he has a genuine concern and interest in the people who work with him. And I have gone with him as he's gone into a hotel, one of his hotels, of which there were 5,000. He has 700,000 people who wear a Marriott brand insignia on their uniform every day. And he gets to know the people behind the desk. He goes into the kitchen. He meets the staff. He asks them about their family, about their life, how many years have been with Marriott, who else they've worked with, what they've learned. His interest is so extraordinary that it creates loyalty towards him and towards the enterprise, and he cares genuinely about their concerns. And what I find unusual is that seems to be carried on not just among the few people around him, but to the whole organization. That genuine concern for others, the customers, the people who work with you, is characteristic of the entire enterprise. So leaders are, I think, chosen in part because of their capacity to make good decisions, but the other is to attract and retain and motivate great people. And so Bill Marriott is one who exhibits that in a way that I think is most unusual.
So talk about what it's like to be in the Senate. Because now, when you're a governor or you're running a business, you have executive authority, and then you exhibit and demonstrate the leadership in the way you think is it's best demonstrated. In the Senate, it's not that. It's 100 people. It's nobody's in. I mean, I guess Mitch McConnell's kind of in charge, at least of the Republican side. But it's a body. It's a legislative body. And I'm just curious how you're adjusting to that. How you're thinking about that.
It's a very different experience from being in business or being a governor. I remember I saw George W. Bush when he was president. He said, you know what, Mitt? He said, being a governor is the best job in America. He said, well, almost the best job in America. I mean, a governor is a fantastic experience because you get to work with young people in their schools and make schools better. You work with public safety and transportation. You're able to do a lot of things, and that's thrilling. You're having an impact on people's lives. A legislator has a different role. It's a deliberative role, not much gets done through a legislature, but it plays a vital role. It's, in a lot of respects, the brakes. Mitch McConnell, on my first day in the Senate, said, you know, a long time ago, one of the nation's founders was asked why we have a Senate instead of just a unicameral legislature. And he said, I think it was Washington, he said, indicated that the House of Representatives is like a cup of hot tea, boiling. With tea boiling over the side of the cup, and it falls into a saucer, and the saucer is the Senate. It cools things down, and very little escapes the Senate. and he said
that's not in the Federalist Papers.
And he said that and Mitch goes on to say, and I subscribe to this now, having been there for a while, that the purpose of this is to make sure that major pieces of legislation are agreed to on a bipartisan basis. as opposed to just one side. Otherwise, every time you had a change in majority, you'd go from a 21% tax rate to corporations up to a 40% tax rate, and individual rates would go back and forth, and people would not know how to invest, where to invest, and you'd want to stay away from America and go somewhere else where there was some continuity. So the Senate provides more continuity. We don't pass a lot of stuff, but that's, in fact, a good thing. And so, you know, I recognize that that's going to be part of the job. I'll tell you one more thing, and that is, I assume that senators would be very, very sort of prickly, that Republicans would, you know, look across the aisle at Democrats and not want to spend much time with them. It's very different than I expected. It's much more collegial and friendly than I expected. I mean, I was walking home from church one day on Capitol Hill, and someone yelled out, "Hey, Mitt, I was just new on Capitol Hill. And she said, "Stop, it's one of your colleagues." And I turned around, it was Kirsten Gillibrand, and a senator from New York. And she said, "You know, welcome to the neighborhood. Let me tell you where you should buy your meats and your breads, and come on over for dinner and meet my two sons." And she brought her husband over, and it's like, wow, this was like my first weekend on Capitol Hill.
Okay, so let's talk about the Republican Party, which from the time you first ran for president to today, I would observe has evolved quite a bit. You are the junior senator from Utah, but you've got a position in the party given the history that you have in the party, and you've been pretty vocal, particularly of late, about what you've watched with the president and otherwise. Why have you felt that it was the right thing to step up and say what you've said, and how does it feel to you when you see the tweets and how the president reacts, and where is that going? And just talk about that.
I don't worry about the tweets and the attacks. If you can't handle criticism, then don't get in politics, all right? That's part of it. I mean, it's like you want to be a professional athlete, guess what? You're going to get beaten up by one side or the other every day. Same thing in politics. Politics is sport for old guys. And so that's just part of the sport. So you don't worry about that. And frankly, the president likes to say controversy carries message. And, you know, the more the president beats up on me, the more visibility I get, the more my point of view gets heard, fine. Let everybody hear what I have to say. That's just fine with me. I can say that I think we're a party that has moved on a number of issues. I'm one of those Republicans who believes that deficits ultimately matter, and the size of the national debt is an issue. And I know that's not terribly current in my party today, but I happen to believe that. I believe that the Russians and the North Koreans and the Iranians are kind of bad guys, and that we should treat other people, all people, with respect, but we should recognize that they're not our friends and keep a dialogue with them, but hold them off. I'm one of those who believe that character and the qualities of character are important elements that are communicated by leaders of all kinds and is something that we should aspire to in all of our leaders. And so on a number of bases, I'm in a different place than some of my party. But, you know, Ronald Reagan used to talk about, you know, the big tent Republican Party. I think, you know, I know some people disagree with me. They think, Mitt, you should never criticize another Republican, particularly our president. But I think it's fine to have people see that folks within the same party have different points of view. And you can be at home in the Republican Party even if you don't agree with everything that's being said from the administration. And that there are Republicans who have different points of view, but that are nonetheless convinced that conservative principles are the best principles for growing an economy, helping people get good jobs, and actually raising real wages. As a party, I think we fail to understand sometimes the importance of communicating why we pursue the policies we do, which are to give people a more prosperous life and a more free life. I didn't do as good a job on that as I wish I would have when I was running for president. But I'm absolutely convinced that our policies are best for helping people in America and preserving our freedoms. But I don't agree with everything the president says, nor would he agree with everything I say. And I think it's healthy to have that kind of a discourse open in an open setting. I know others don't think so, and that's they're entitled to that point of view.
So let's talk for a second about the impeachment process. Mm-hmm. It's kind of disconcerting. I'll just make my own opinion. Disconcerting to watch what's transpired around the Ukrainian situation, and it's disconcerting to watch any impeachment process as a citizen and as a voter. when you kind of see the, you know, the whole country's focus and attention get geared towards impeachment as opposed to the business of the country.
Yeah, yeah.
What is your view on this process? You've been vocal. Some people call you a pressure point in the Senate around this, and it's ultimately going to come to the Senate if this keeps going the way it looks like it's going to go. How do you think we should think about that? How do you feel about what the Senate will do? What's your perspective on the process? What comments would you make on it?
Not a lot of comments, and that's in part because the process is at an early stage, and you know how the process works, which is the House makes a decision as to whether or not to pursue a potential impeachment and then to actually bring an impeachment forward with articles of impeachment. They made the decision to proceed. That's their choice. I don't tell them what they should do. And Speaker Pelosi and her associates said we should pursue this avenue of investigation, which they're undertaking. And so, again, I don't try and judge them in their choice. When they bring something forward to the Senate, we will then have something more akin to the trial process we're used to in a judicial setting, where we'll review the evidence, we'll probably listen to various witnesses, and we'll each, as senators, in some respects as a jury, make a decision. It would, in my opinion, be ill-advised for me, or perhaps for others, but at least for me, to prejudge what that would look like, particularly when we don't know what kind of evidence is going to come forward. Hearings have been held in a confidential setting so far. A whistleblower is entitled to express his or her points of view, but ultimately the evidence will come forward as to whether or not the whistleblower was providing information that's valid or not, and we'll make that decision. So at this stage, I'm going to wait and see what comes forward and do my very best to judge at that point.
Okay, good. Fair enough. Let's shift to domestic policy, domestic mm-hmm. affairs. And I want to start on the economy because you, with all the background you have in business as a governor, running the Olympics, you've always, to me, had a finger on the pulse of what's going on in the economy. What's your perspective on the U.S. economy as you watch it today? What are you worried about? What do you talk about when you're in the Senate when it comes to the economic issues? And then I want to start getting into the budget and national debt issues as you raised earlier.
Well, I'm probably an outlier in this regard. I don't think we're going into recession. I think we'll continue to have a growing economy. I'm not an economist. I don't begin to deal with the kinds of currency issues that you deal with and the kinds of flows that you're seeing. So I'm not going to make predictions in that regard. But I can say from my own perspective that when you have an economy that's growing and then you take the corporate tax rate down to 21%, and you allow repatriation of a trillion or however dollars back into the U.S. from overseas by corporate America, and you spend an extra trillion a year, more than you take in taxes. You know, we took in $3 trillion in taxes, we spend $4 trillion. Those are all highly stimulative events. And I believe those stimulative features will continue to propel our economy in a positive way. I look at consumer sentiment. Consumers are still buying. They read the articles about some troubling signs. I don't think there's 1 out of 10 that worries about the inverted yield curve because they have no idea what it means, or what. Nor do I. My own view is that, and the signs that I see are positive from the standpoint of our economy, particularly because it's overwhelmingly driven by consumer spending. I do see a lot of corporations that are wondering what they should do, in part because of the whole tariff philosophy that has been promoted by this administration. And I'm not just talking about the China policy, but with regards to steel and aluminum tariffs and other tariffs with the EU, they kind of wonder where it's going and what it means, where should they put their next facility and which type of equipment should they buy. And so I think corporate America is sort of holding off a bit. And, you know, the challenge with any kind of recession, you know, it was said some time ago by the chairman of the Federal Reserve that recessions are the result of irrational behavior, and it's hard to predict irrational behavior. Yeah. And so you don't know what things will cause things to precipitate, but when people get worried, why that can cause that to occur. But unless there's a precipitating event of some kind, of a significant kind, I don't think that will happen. That we'll go into recession. So I'm kind of bullish on the economy, I've been wrong before. I had a partner who predicted 7 of the last 2 recessions, and so
we have a few of those at Goldman Sachs.
So we'll see where it goes. Clearly, seeing around the world, China's slowing down a lot. Yeah. Asia's slowing down. Germany is slowing down. Italy, major parts of the EU are slowing down. And those things are a drag on our economy. I just don't think they're a big enough drag to overcome the tax and stimulative events that have happened over the last couple of years.
Okay. So you mentioned your view that the U.S. balance sheet matters.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That long term, it will ultimately has impact. And you talked about that when you were running for president.
Yeah.
And you continue to talk about that. It isn't in vogue to talk about it.
No.
I tend to agree with you. It's important. So maybe just give a little more perspective on why you think it's important. You also, as I remember from conversations we've had in the past, are pretty articulate on what the balance sheet is, how it works, how big a problem the entitlements are. Just talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. Just a couple of points, and you guys know this as well as I presume. Some years ago, I had the chance to meet with John Whitehead, who was formerly in your position at Goldman and became chairman of the Fed in New York. And I said, Mr. Whitehead, what worries you? He says, I'm worried someday we're going to have a failed auction. We won't be able to turn over our debt. And I don't share that worry. I did back then, but I don't share that worry today. There just aren't many good options for people who want a safe place to put their money besides the U.S. dollar. And not the euro. China doesn't really have the kind of fluid capital markets that would allow people to put money there on a predictable basis. And so I think the dollar's the place. We're the reserve currency of the world. So I think we can keep floating debt, for a long, long, long time. The challenge is we have to pay interest on the debt. And I know the interest rate is low, but last year we spent about $300 billion on interest on the federal debt. And to put that in context, the president closed down the government for a month in January, trying to get $5 billion for a wall. We spent $300 billion on interest. It's real money, and the CBO says that's going to get to a number that's even larger than our military budget, which is a little over $700 billion. And if you're spending hundreds of billions of dollars in interest, that puts you in a weaker position, particularly if the money is going to other nations that are using that money to stand up a military to confront your own. So it's a challenge. And of course, if you look at our federal spending, two-thirds of it is automatic. Two-thirds of it is not voted on by Congress. And we get all excited in Congress about, there's this wasteful program and this one's growing too much. But you know what? Two-thirds is automatic. Only one-third is in the budget that we vote on. And of that one-third, half is the military and half is everything else government does. But the two-thirds, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, and other entitlements and interest, that's two-thirds. So if we're going to finally deal with this issue long-term, and again, I don't think we have an immediate crisis that we're going to hit on debt, but long-term, we're going to have to be honest to young people coming along about what the deal is going to be for your Medicare and Social Security and Medicaid. And those programs, I think, have to be adjusted, not to affect current retirees or people that are nearing retirement, but for younger people. We got to be honest and say, look, higher income people aren't going to get as big a benefit as lower income people. Higher income people are going to have to pay a larger share of their health care bill and of their living expenses. We may have to increase the retirement age a couple of years. These are the kinds of things which, if we do them now, can be done relatively with modest pain. But at some point, if it comes down the road, why these things can be very, very difficult to deal with. And if we don't deal with them, why we could find ourselves in a very severe economic setting where we do face the kind of a debt crisis that suggests that interest rates start going up. I don't see the interest rates going up because we can't sell our bonds but at some point that could be an issue.
Do you sense any real will in Washington to have this conversation? Do you think it'll be a real topic in the presidential election?
I do not think it'll be a topic in the presidential election. I think there's a truce by both parties, which is, we're going to talk about the programs we're going to give, the things we're going to do for people, and the idea of saying, hey, we need some more austerity in some of our safety net programs, Medicare, Social Security, Medicaid. There's just no interest in doing that. None. maybe I'm overstating it. There are a few of us that talk about it, but I doubt it'll be part of a presidential campaign or other campaigns. I saw a map, by the way, that Axios put out of what's the number one issue in each state in the 2018 races that we just had. And there's only one state where the debt was the number one issue, Utah. All right. So we in Utah care about spending more than we take in.
Yeah.
But the rest of the country just wasn't an issue. So I am working with another Democrat senator right now to propose and see if we can get the leadership of both parties to agree to a process, just to a process that lets us take on this issue on a bipartisan basis. You remember Bowles Simpson?
Bowles Simpson style.
It's a Bowles Simpson approach to say, how do we deal with this such that we can give the next president the opportunity to make some changes here? Because anytime you talk about Social Security, the opposition party is going to say, oh, you're cutting benefits to seniors, and you're going to get crushed in the ballot box. And so no one wants to talk about it during a presidential race. Paul Ryan and I did. By the way, we won among people 65 and older because they understood we weren't going to be attacking them, and we have to change these programs for younger folks. But this is an issue. I think we'll get there, but it's probably not going to be before 2020.
Yep. Okay. Healthcare.
Yeah.
You, when you were governor, you passed a plan in Massachusetts that would not have been a Republican orthodoxy, you know, kind of a plan. We have Obamacare, which has gotten a lot of, you know, kind of, there's a lot of angst around Obamacare in your party. What is your perspective on the solution for healthcare today as we sit here now?
Well, I think Obamacare, the structure of Obamacare, I think, is fatally affected by the decision to say no more mandated requirement to have insurance, because then you have adverse selection, which is people that are healthy say, well, I'm not going to buy insurance. People who are sick buy insurance, and therefore insurance gets very expensive, so more and more people drop out. I mean, it just stops working. So I think Obamacare is in real trouble and will have to be replaced. My own view is that rather than have the federal government decide how to get 15% of the population that has been uninsured, how to get that number insured, that we're better to let each state care for its own low-income population, uninsured population, in the way they think best. And recognize that Obamacare did not deal with the 85 or 90% of people who are insured. It dealt only with those that were uninsured. And so trying to deal with that whole array, I mean, this whole idea of Medicare for all, let's throw out all of our insurance system and have the federal government run everything. My goodness, I think that's a terrible approach. Massive undertaking with all sorts of unintended consequences. But look, we got a problem for 10 to 15% of our population uninsured. Let's send money back to the states and say to the state, you care for the people in the way you think best. If you want an Obamacare-style program, that's your choice. If you want a Medicare-type program in your state, fine. You want clinics to provide free care to people, that's fine. Each state do your own thing, and maybe some state comes up with something so great everybody else will copies it.
Block grants to the states.
Let states craft their own plans. But right now, by the way, politically, there's very little interest in this topic, what I'm just describing. The real interest is in prescription drug costs, because that's what we're paying for out of our pocket, and surprise billing, which is when people think they're in an in-network setting in a hospital with an in-network doctor, and then they go home and get a bill for $20,000 from the anesthesiologist and from some others that were not in the network they didn't even know about. Those are things people want to see answers to, and that'll, be part of the political discussion.
Climate. You've made some comments about climate. You've acknowledged that climate's an issue. And I have to say, when I travel around the world in my job, I don't go anywhere where this isn't asked of me in terms of what Goldman Sachs' views are, what our policies are, how we think about it, you know, what our strategies are. Just talk a bit about your views on climate.
Yeah, no, I think we have to take aggressive action to reduce the human contribution to greenhouse gases and to global warming. And I have my own view about the approaches that I think have the most merit. But, you know, I say to my colleagues who say to me, I don't think we're causing global warming. I say, what is there a 1 out of 10 chance we're causing it? I say, well, yeah. I mean, I think it's more like 9 out of 10 chance. But even if you think it's a 1 out of 10 chance, and if it's going to be as catastrophic as that would suggest, if you believed you had a 1 to 10 chance of this terrible thing happening, wouldn't you do something to try and make it better? And by the way, don't you hope it's being caused by human activity? Because if it's not, there's nothing we can do about it. Right. So I hope it's being caused by us. So we have a shot of doing something. All right, so I don't pretend to be a scientist, but every scientist I know says we're causing it. So let's do whatever we can to see if we can't fix it. Now, I have a couple of other just quick points on it. One is, it is a global issue. If we were to get rid of all the cars in America and turn off all of our power plants, CO2 emissions at the global level continue to go up. Yeah. So just tweaking things here in the U.S. doesn't solve the problem. We have to find a way for China, Brazil, India, Indonesia, the other big areas where CO2 emissions are growing, we have to find technologies that they want to adopt because they're less expensive. For that to happen, we need innovation. So for me, the answer is innovation in energy, in transportation, in cement manufacture, and steel manufacture. We need innovation. So I look for solutions that create innovations that will be adopted globally. And how do you encourage that? Well, a carbon tax would potentially encourage that. It has some downsides, so it's got some pluses and minuses. Alternatively, or perhaps in combination, tax credits for the construction of facilities that are breakthrough technology type facilities or technologies, that could play a role. Alternatively or in combination, additional funding in research, government labs, universities, and so forth. But it's, in my view, the key to dealing with global warming is technology. It is innovation. And that we should be devoting our resources to those things which make innovation occur, not just at the government level, but in the private sector all over the world.
Let's talk about foreign policy. I guess I'll start with China, but maybe even at a higher level, we do have quite a unilateral approach. And China would be a good example where we kind of went after China by ourselves after going after everybody else, you know, kind of simultaneously or a little before. What's your perspective on that approach? How do we get out of that approach? What is the right approach? And then more specifically, let's talk about where we are with China.
Well, I agree with you. I think the right approach for pushing back on China would have been to start by getting our friends around the world to collaborate and to say, hey, look, we got a problem with China. They're stealing our technologies. They're using industrial policy to put our businesses out of business. And we got to stop this. Let's do that on a collective basis. Let's meet with the Chinese in a quiet way so they don't lose face if they have to make some changes. But let's let them know it can't keep on going the way it's going. That is not the approach that was taken. A far more confrontational approach was taken. That's not the approach I'd have taken, but we'll see where it proceeds. But I do believe the president was right to confront China. Yep. So the approach may not be the one I'd have taken. Maybe his will be better. I don't know. But I do think that it was appropriate to confront China because China's going to become the economic giant after I'm gone. But some of you will be around in part because they got a huge population, 1.4 billion people. As they keep on buying more things and their economy becomes more and more modern, they're going to become the largest economy in the world. They'll have the largest military in the world, and they want to become the geopolitical, economic, and military leader of the world. And if they're pursuing authoritarianism and industrial policies that drive other people out of business, that's a real problem. And so how do you can't just sit back and let that happen. And so in my view, we have to confront China to get them to adopt a series of measures that are consistent with global norms, global trading practices, global military understandings, international law. And so we've got to move them in that direction. But they can't be allowed just to run all over us, which is what they're doing now. And so I applaud the effort to push back on China. I would note that a smaller country, 330 million, us, facing a larger country, 1.4 billion, long term, the way we win is by linking arms with our friends. Because we have friends. They don't. We have lots of friends. Even their neighbors are our friends. So linking arms with them economically, militarily, geopolitically, getting closer to our allies is key to us having the economic might to convince China to turn its course away from the confrontational approach they've taken so far and the predatory approach they've taken so far. And so my view is get closer to Europe. Make sure Europe is strong. I want Europe to be strong. I want Japan to be strong. I want Australia. I want each of these people to be strong, to respect us, to want to work with us, to have more trade amongst ourselves, and to have China say, hey, I want to get into that. I want to be more a part of that. And I think that's something that, China has an extraordinary strategy. And they are really effective using industrial policy as the tip of their spear to confront the West. And we don't have a strategy. We really don't have an effective strategy to say how we're going to deal with them economically and militarily and geopolitically. And it's high time for us to do so.
Let's talk about Syria, which is obviously, kind of very tough to watch at the moment. What's your perspective on where we are? And this was, you called it a betrayal, which I think you called it a betrayal, which is a word I would have used also. It's spurred a rebuke, which I think is good, but we're in a tough place. What's your perspective on it?
Well, we just had a task force, bipartisan task force, that spent almost 2 years evaluating what's happening in Syria and laying it out region by region and who's in charge. And it was an extraordinary piece of work done by Republicans and Democrats outside of elected office. And they came in and presented to the Senate their findings in an extraordinary report just 2 weeks ago and laying out why it's very much in America's interest to remain involved in Syria. Not throwing in troops, but we have roughly 2,000 troops there, enough to provide some stability, and then there's some things we want to be able to do politically, if you will, to try and change the political course of parts of the nation, and so we play a very important role there. I mean, we say we should do what's in America's interest, and there's this movement around the world for nations to say, hey, why are we doing things in other nations? We should just focus on things here at home. Well, the reason we do things around the world is because of our interest. It's in our interest to be involved in the world, because what happens in the rest of the world affects us. I mean, Harry Truman, following the Second World War, sat down with Dean Acheson, and Dean wrote a book called Present at the Creation, and in there they said, look, the keys of American foreign policy have to, one, we have to be involved in the world, because if we're not, bad things happen that draw us in. Number two, we have to promote our values, democracy, free enterprise, human rights. And number three, we have to be strong, and we are strengthened by linking arms with our friends. That's been the basis of American foreign policy, because that's in our interest. It's not that we're out just thinking that we're being do-gooders or that we're policemen of the world because we like being policemen. No, it's in our interest. So Syria, it's in our interest not to have millions of people rush into Europe from Syria and destabilize Europe, because it's our friend and a trading partner. It's not in our interest to have them rush in, have the Iranians rush in and disrupt Israel and put pressure on Israel, because we trade with Israel and we care about people there. So it's in our interest to see stability in Syria, and that's why we've had a couple of thousand troops there. I don't know exactly what the president's done with troops, because there have been different reports. His tweet said that, we're getting out of endless wars. And yet I don't think we pulled out any troops. I think we just moved them from one place to another. I don't know that, but my reading is, and again, by reading the newspapers, we moved 150 or so troops from one place to another. But it effectively, apparently, opened the door.
Just opened the lane.
Opened a lane for the Turks to come in and start bombing our friends. And I just think it is very bad long-term for American interest, for people who have been our friends and allies, who fought with us shoulder to shoulder, to see us turn and run away from them for no apparent reason. And I think, and even for any reason, I think you stand by your friends at all cost. And anything other than that is seen as a betrayal, and the cost will be borne, if not immediately, long term. And seeing our Kurdish friends die is one of the saddest things I've seen during my lifetime.
So, another tough spot, Iran. And you said earlier, they're one of the bad guys. What's your perspective on where we are with Iran, and how would you handle Iran, which is a really complicated... It seems like we don't have a lot of good options.
The pressure campaign on Iran, I do support. I think the deal that was worked out by Secretary Kerry and President Obama was the wrong deal. That was my own view, and I wrote about it at the time and said we're far better to keep the sanctions in place along with our friends to put pressure on Iran and to get them to be dissuaded from becoming a nuclear power. At this stage, I don't know whether they will ever agree to give up their nuclear ambition, but I think it's important for them and the world to know that there is a high cost if you want to take on the desire to become a nuclear power, that there is a very high cost that will exist for a substantial period of time. I don't know how long that'll be. I certainly hope that the pressure we put on them will dissuade them from having nuclear weapons that can be mounted on rockets to attack our friends and ourselves. But I think we should put a lot of pressure on them and make them pay a heavy cost for the decision they've taken and for their continued malevolence in the Middle East and beyond. I do believe when they carry out a provocative action, as they have once shooting down a drone, that we should have a military response, and one which is not designed to escalate the conflict, but to point out that there, again, is a cost. That you shoot down something of ours, we'll shoot down something of yours. And you didn't kill any of our people, we'll endeavor not to kill any of your people, but we will show you that there will be a cost. And with regards to Saudi Arabia, my own view there is we were not attacked, Saudi Arabia was. It's up to Saudi Arabia to determine if they want to respond in some kind of a military way. And we would support their response. I don't think we should be out carrying out military attacks to protect the Saudis. I think the Saudis have the capacity to do that on their own. We've sold them a lot of weapons, done a lot of training, and I think they have that capacity. But a continued pressure effort against the Iranians, I think, is appropriate given their malevolent activity and their nuclear, their clear nuclear ambition.
Let's give Senator Romney a round of applause.
Thank you.